You're listening to The Life of Jesus Christ in a Year, from the visions of Anne Catherine Emmerich from TAN. I'm Father Edward Looney, and each day I will be reading and offering commentary to guide you through Anne Catherine Emmerich's magnificent mystical revelations. In addition to listening, you can follow along with the four-volume hardcover set of The Life of Jesus Christ in Biblical Revelations, available from TAN. Before we get to today's reading, let us ask the intercession of our venerable author. O blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich, devout and pious follower of Christ, who patiently endured the frailty of this mortal condition, who humbly received the honorable marks of Christ Jesus on your hands, feet, side, head, and chest, the marks which you are blessed by the Lord to witness for yourself in his own sufferings. We graciously ask for your intercession with God, that we sinners may be forgiven of our sins and be drawn more completely into spiritual communion with Christ our Lord and Savior. We ask this in the name of the Most Holy Lamb of God, and through the intercession of Mary, our Mother. Amen. Today is day number 15, and in this episode, we will continue reading from Volume 1, and we'll start Section 16, Joseph and Aseneth. Joseph was 16 years old when he was sold into Egypt. He was of middle height, very slender and agile, active both in body and mind. He was indeed very different from his brothers, and all felt drawn to love him. Were it not for the marked preference shown him by his father, his brothers also would have loved him. Reuben was of a more lively disposition than the others. Benjamin was a large, ungainly man, but very good-natured, easily led. Joseph wore his hair divided into three, one part on either side of his head, the third falling down behind in long curls. When ruler over Egypt, he wore it short, but afterward allowed it again to grow. When Jacob bestowed the many-colored coat upon Joseph, he gave over to him also some of the bones of Adam, without telling him. However, what they were, Jacob gave them to Joseph as a precious talisman, for he knew well that his brothers did not love him. Joseph carried the bones on his breast in a little leathern bag rounded on top. When his brothers sold him, they took from him only the colored coat and his customary outer garment, but left the band and a sort of scapular on his breast, beneath which he had hung the little bag. The colored coat was white with broad wet red stripes. It had on the breast three rows of black cord crossing one another, in the center of which were yellow ornaments. It was full around the breast. When bound at the waist, the fullness served as a pocket. It was narrower toward the lower part of the skirt and had slits at the side to render motion easier. It fell below the knee, was somehow longer in the back and open in front. Joseph's ordinary dress did not reach to the knees. Joseph was known to Pharaoh and his wife before his imprisonment. Potiphar's affairs were so flourishing under Joseph's management. Potiphar himself was so blessed during Joseph's stay under his roof, since he conducted all things so well for Pharaoh, that the latter was eager to see the faithful servant. Pharaoh's wife, who was religiously inclined and very desirous of salvation, and who had at the same time, like all the Egyptians, a great hankering after new gods, was so astounded at the wise, intelligent, extraordinary young stranger that she honored him interiorly as a divinity. She said repeatedly to Pharaoh, "This man has been sent by our gods. He is not a human being like ourselves." Hence it came to pass that he was thrown not into the common dungeon, but into the prison reserved for the nobility, and there he was made the overseer. Pharaoh's wife sincerely deplored his conviction as a malefactor and thought that she had been mistaken in him. But when he was liberated and again appeared at court, she treated him with great distinction. The cup that Joseph ordered to be placed in Benjamin's sack was the first present the queen had made to him. I know it well. It had two handles, but no foot. It seemed to have been cut out of one of the precious stone or one solid transparent mass, I know not which, and was used in shape exactly like the upper part of the chalice used at the Last Supper. It was also among the vessels that the children of Israel took away with them from Egypt, and was afterward preserved in the Ark of the Covenant. Joseph was 7 years in prison. During his greatest affliction, he received the mysterious blessing of Jacob in the same manner as the patriarchs had done. He had a vision also of a numerous posterity. I know all about Potiphar's wife. I saw how desirous she was to pervert Joseph, but after his elevation, she did penance and became chaste and devout. She was a tall, powerful woman, her skin of a yellowish brown and shining like silk. She wore a colored robe over which was one of a figured gauze. The lower one shone through it, as if through lace. Joseph was thrown much with her, since his master's affairs were all entrusted to him. But when he became aware of the fact that she had grown more familiar in her manner toward him, he no longer remained in the house overnight, during his master's absence. She often intruded herself upon him when he was busy at his writing. Once I saw her enter his presence in immodest attire. He was standing writing in one corner of a hall. In those days, they used to write upon rolls of parchment which hung on the wall. The writer either sat or stood before them. She addressed him and replied. Then she grew bolder, seeing which he turned hurriedly away. She grasped his mantle, but he fled, leaving it in her hand. I saw Joseph with Potiphar's pagan priests at Heliopolis. Aseneth, the daughter of Dinah, and the Sycamite lived with them as a prophetess and a decorator of the idols. 7 other maidens were her companions. Potiphar had bought her from her nurse in her 5th year. This nurse had fled with her to the Red Sea by order of Jacob, that the child might not be murdered by his sons. Aseneth possessed the spirit of prophecy and was esteemed by Potiphar as a prophetess. Joseph knew her, but he knew not that she was his niece. She was of a very earnest character. She sought seclusion, and in spite of her great beauty, she abhorred the society of men. She was favored with significant visions, was familiar with the Egyptian star worship, and had a secret presentiment of the religion of the patriarchs. I saw no witchcraft connected with her. She saw in a vision the whole mystery of life, the transplanting, the coming to, and the departure of Israel from Egypt, even the long journey through the wilderness. She wrote many rolls on the leaves of a water plant or on skin. The letters were strange looking. They were like the heads of birds and animals. These writings were, even during her lifetime, misunderstood by the Egyptians and misconstrued into a sanction for their wicked abominations. Aseneth grieved deeply over the misconception brought about by the evil one, and she shed many tears. She had more numerous visions than any other of her time. She was filled with wondrous wisdom. She conducted herself gravely and refused advice to none. She could weave also and embroider. Her enlightened spirit detected man's corruption of truth. Therefore, was she grave, reserved, retiring, and silent. I saw that the misconception of Aseneth's visions and writings led to her being worshipped under the name of Isis, and Joseph under that of Osiris. This perhaps was the cause of her abundant tears. She also wrote against her erroneous conception of her visions, which had led her to their proclaiming her the mother of all the gods. When Putiphar offered sacrifice, Aseneth ascended a tower upon which she seemed to be, as it were, in a little garden. Here she gazed upon the stars by moonlight. She fell into ecstasy and read all things clearly in the stars. The truth was shown her in pictures, because she was chosen of God. I have seen the pagan priests introduced into strange, diabolical worlds, where they beheld the most abominable things. By such diabolical visions were the secret communications of Aseneth disfigured and made to contribute to the abominations of idolatry. Aseneth introduced many useful arts and domestic animals into Egypt, among the latter, for instance, the cow. She taught the art of making cheese, that of weaving, and many others hitherto unknown to the inhabitants. She also healed many diseases. The plow was introduced by Joseph, who was himself skilled in its use. There was one thing that seemed truly wonderful to me. Aseneth ordered the flesh of the numerous animals slaughtered for sacrifice to be boiled down until it became a gelatinous mass, which served for food on campaigns and in times of scarcity. The operation was carried on in the open air and in cauldrons in the earth. The Egyptians were rejoiced and amazed at this new mode of procuring food. When Joseph met Aseneth at the pagan priest's dwelling, she approached to embrace him. This she did not through boldness, but impelled by the spirit. It was in her a kind of prophetic action and took place in presence of the pagan priest. Aseneth was looked upon as holy, but I saw Joseph keep her off with outstretched hand and address earnest words to her. Then Aseneth, deeply agitated, retired to her own room, where she remained in tears and penance. I saw her in her chamber. She stood concealed by a curtain, her wealth of long and beautiful hair falling around her and curling at the ends. There was impressed upon the skin of the pit of her stomach a wonderful sign. In a figure like a heart-shaped shell stood a child with outstretched arms, holding in one hand a small dish, in the other a cup or chalice. In the dish were three young ears of corn that appeared to be just breaking out of the husk, and the figure of a dove, which seemed to peck after the grapes in the cup held by the child. Jacob knew of this sign, but notwithstanding, he had to send the child away in order to shield her from the rage of his sons. But when he came down into Egypt and Joseph told him all things, he recognized his granddaughter by this mark. Joseph, too, had a mark of the same kind upon his breast, a very full bunch of grapes. Now I saw an angel appear in resplendent raiment, holding a lotus in his hand. He saluted Aseneth. She glanced at him and drew her veil around her. He commanded her to dry her tears, to adorn herself in festal robes, and he also requested her to bring him food. She left the room and returned adorned as directed, bringing with her a low table, small and light, upon which were wine and little flat loaves that had been baked in ashes. Aseneth evinced no fear. She was not shy, but simple and humble. Just like Abraham and the other patriarchs, when treating with apparitions. When the angel now spoke to her, she unveiled. He asked her for some honey, but she replied that, unlike other maidens who are fond of it, she had none. Thereupon, the angel told her that she would find some among the idols that stood in the chamber. These idols were of various forms. They had heads of animals, and for bodies, serpents coiled downward. Aseneth looked and found a beautiful coarse-celled honeycomb, white as the host of our altars. She set it before the angel, who bade her eat of it. He blessed it, and I saw it shining and flashing between them. I cannot now express the signification of this heavenly honey, for when one sees such things, it is just as they actually are. One knows all. But now when I try to recall it, the honey appears to be what is called honey. Yet I know not what the flowers, the bees, and the honey properly signified. I could only say this much. Aseneth really possessed in herself only bread and wine, or that which is typified by bread and wine. But she had no honey. By the reception of this honey, she issued from idolatry into the light of Israel, into salvation through the old law. It signified also that she should aid many souls, that many like bees should build around her. I heard her say that she would drink no more wine, for that now she was more in need of honey. I saw numbers of bees and vast stores of honey in Midian near Jethro. In blessing the honeycomb, the angel directed his finger toward all regions of the world, which signified that by her presence, her types, and the mystery of its own, the honey's signification. Aseneth should be a mother and a leader. When later on she was honored as a divinity and represented with numerous breasts, it was in consequence of the misconception of her vision that she should nourish many. The angel told her that she was destined to be united with Joseph, that she should be his bride, and he blessed her as Isaac had blessed Jacob, and as the angel had blessed Abraham. The three lines that constituted the formula of the blessing were drawn upon her twice, once to the pit of the stomach and once to the abdomen. After this, I saw in vision Joseph going to Potiphar to demand Aseneth for his wife. But I can only remember that, like the angel, he carried a lotus in his hand. Joseph knew of Aseneth's wonderful wisdom, but their mutual relationship was hidden from both. I saw that Pharaoh's son likewise was in love with Aseneth, on which account she had to remain secluded. He had persuaded Dan and Gad to espouse his cause, and all three lay in ambush to slay Joseph. But Judah, obeying a divine inspiration, I think, warned Joseph to take another route. Benjamin also conducted himself nobly in this affair and defended Aseneth. Dan and Gad were punished by the death of their children, or even before it was known to anyone, they had been warned not to enlist in the murderous design. When Joseph and Aseneth appeared in public, like the pagan priests of Potiphar, they bore in their hand a sign regarded as sacred and emblematic of the highest authority. The upper part was a ring, the lower a Latin cross, a T. It served as a seal, and when grain was measured and divided, the heaps were marked with it. It was used in the same way for the building of granaries and canals, also for the rising and falling of the Nile. Writings were sealed with it after they had first been marked with a red vegetable juice. When Joseph discharged any official duty, the symbol of authority, the cross, being clasped in the ring, lay on a cushion at his side. It seemed to me also like a distinctive sign of the mystery of the Ark of the Covenant still enclosed in Joseph. Aseneth also had an instrument like a wand. When in vision, she followed wherever it led. Where it quivered, she struck the earth, and so discovered springs of water. It was made under the influence of the stars. We're going to bring our reading to a pause, and we'll finish this section in tomorrow's reading. So we have quite the interesting story that's unfolding in our reading today about Joseph and Aseneth. Admittedly, Aseneth is newer to me, and I guess I didn't really know the backstory of Joseph. We heard Joseph is the one, you know, he has the brothers are envious, the brothers, you know, leave him for dead, sell him into slavery. But then he is caught up in this royal family and such. This is the Joseph of the technicolor dream coat that so many have seen that play or musical. I think one of the things that strikes me in this reading is simply the repentance of individuals, that they realize by their actions they've offended God, they've offended others. I knew all about Potiphar's wife. I saw how desirous she was to pervert Joseph. But after his elevation, she did penance and became chaste and devout. So there's an example of someone doing a little bit of penance for perverted behavior, in the words of Anne Catherine Emmerich. Another line about penance. Then Aseneth, deeply agitated, retired to her own room, where she remained in tears and penance. And so, personally, I just wonder, what did this penance look like? We kind of know what penances are today and what we do for penances. For example, you know, go to confession, the penance might be an Our Father, a decade of the Rosary, meditating on the Psalms. But what penance were these individuals doing as we're learning about Joseph and Aseneth and kind of the figures around them? We know people would do penance through fasting. How do you do penance? When you're aware of sin in your life, what kind of penance do you do personally? I did this, and now to correct myself, I will do this. To demonstrate my contrition, I will do this. Maybe penance isn't a part of your life outside of the penance of confession. Perhaps today, just an invitation to mull over. In what ways do I do penance? One simple act of self-denial that sometimes I'll do, I will, you know, deny myself something. Let's say I'm out and about and I want to go through the drive-thru somewhere like a Dunkin' Donuts and get a cup of coffee. Well, I sometimes will do that as I'll deny myself as an act of self-denial. I do it for the betterment of who I am as a person, and sometimes it's good to say no to those desires that we have. But now what if I was to do that as a penance? As I deny myself a coffee beverage in the afternoon, all I have to do is say, Lord God, I offer you this sacrifice. I offer you this as a penance to atone for my sins. Penances were being done already here in the Old Testament with these figures. How much more should we be doing penance in our life? This brings us to an end of our reading and reflection for today. Please be sure to subscribe to the podcast to sign up for email notifications at emmerichpodcast.com and use coupon code ACE25 for 25% off your next order at tanbooks.com. I hope you'll join us next time as we continue meditating on the life of Jesus Christ and biblical revelation with the help of Anne Catherine Emmerich. Until then, may God bless you. And Mary pray for you.